Will the congregation please rise? Color detail, forward, march. Color detail, halt. Color detail, cross the colors. Color detail, post the colors. Color detail, reform. Color detail, dismissed. Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Philadelphia Presbyterian Church. It is a joy to be with you this morning. Thank you to the scouts and the leaders for joining us in worship today and helping to participate in our service. We are grateful for your presence. Friends, as we begin today and we join into worship, I have a few announcements for you. First announcement is about the upcoming scholarship season. If you are a senior in high school, or if you have a senior in high school, you know that college applications and scholarship applications are right around the corner, and you're probably doing them right now, actually. We want to let you know that Philadelphia Church has a few scholarships that we are able to offer because of a generous endowment fund that we have been blessed to steward. So if you are a high school senior, we would encourage you to look at our church webpage at the qualifications for these scholarships to see if you fit them, and if so, please apply. Second announcement today, I want to talk to you about Backpacks of Love. Backpacks is a wonderful ministry that many of you know about. We support 85 families in different schools here in the area by collecting shelf-stable food items, putting them in backpacks each week, and sending them home with kids in school who are not able to have enough food in their homes. So we are wanting to encourage you to continue that support. Thank you for your generous contributions. And also would ask that you join us in prayer about expanding this ministry. Our church received a call this week from Lebanon Elementary asking if we could up the number of bags we do by 50, sending out 50 more bags a week, because in that elementary school there are 50 children who do not have enough food to eat when they go home on the weekends. So the need is great, and that need is in our own community, just minutes from where we are standing right now. So please join us in prayer about expanding the ministry of Backpacks of Love. And if you are able to participate in that, please, please, please do so. Contact the church office and we will make sure that you get connected to the right places. The last announcement I have for you today has to do with the book that I am holding in my hand and that you hopefully will see on a slide here in just a moment. This book is called A Time to Grow: Lenten Lessons from Garden to the Table. Can you believe it? Lent is only a month away. It feels like Christmas just happened, and now we are already talking about Lent. This book is a really exciting book that can teach us a lot about Lent by helping us to think about the food that we eat, the process of growing food, the faith it takes to grow food. If you've ever planted a garden, you know that there is a lot you can do to make sure that food grows, but ultimately you know you can't control that food. There is an element of faith in that planting of the garden. And this book is an exciting new book that helps us think about how the food we grow informs how we think about the faith we have that draws us closer to Christ. So on Wednesday nights from 6 to 7, I will be leading a discussion group along with Pam Jack, and we'll be talking about this book and how our faith can grow during this season of Lent. So please consider joining us on Wednesday nights from 6 to 7, beginning this Wednesday. And we'll talk about how our food can help us to think about growing in the faith. So friends, it is a joy to worship with you. I love seeing all the scout uniforms, and I love seeing folks in this congregation come out to support our scouts. Let us stand now together as we sing hymn 463. How firm a foundation. Let us stand and sing. like to invite Gwen Clark to come up and lead us in our call to confession.
Let us turn to the Most Holy One and confess our sins, confident in God's. Let us turn to the Most Holy One and confess our sins, confident in God's faithful and steadfast love for us. O God, we walk in the midst of trouble. You preserve and deliver us. Though our lips are not clean and our hearts are not pure, you call us. Forgive us, we pray, when we wander away from you, lost and at risk. Forgive when our lives do not reflect your glory and the purposes you intend. Help us to comprehend the ways you will be, and to feel your grace and glory. For you, Emmanuel, we can be healed, set free. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In the temple, Isaiah heard these words. Your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out. God's grace toward us has not been in vain. This good news we have received in Christ's death and resurrection, we have been saved. Thanks be to God.
To invite our children forward and Matt Hall for the children's sermon.
Good morning, kids. Now, some of you I know from church, and some of you I know from Scouts. So does anyone know what this is? It's a fishing rod.
It's a fishing
rod. Does anyone know why I may have a fishing rod today?
No.
Grady? You're learning about fishing for men, that's right. So Pastor Miller is going to be preaching on a scripture today that we're going to hear in a minute from one of the members from the troop that talks where Jesus calls the disciples. And he calls them to become fisher of men. Does anyone know of any famous fishermen in the Bible?
Simon and Peter,
the disciples. Many of them were fishermen. And we're going to hear about how Jesus calls them from being fishermen to be fisher of men. Now, how many of you have been fishing before? A lot of you, right? Now, for any of you cubs, what is the rule when we're at day camp that Mr. Dale teaches us? Not to go near the water. We got to heat up the worms by putting them in our mouth. So I have worms here. Does anyone want to heat up a worm in their mouth? Should I heat up a worm in my mouth? All right. Does that look like a real worm? So what am I supposed to do now? So Mr. Dale teaches us, it's not a real worm. It is a gummy worm that looks real. So don't worry. But Mr. Dale teaches us that as a fun trick before we start fishing, right? But what does Mr. Dale teach us when we're fishing out at Belk? And he teaches how to fish, right? How many of you had to learn fishing from someone? I had to learn fishing from someone. So just like we had to learn fishing, when Jesus calls the disciples to be fisher of men, he has to teach them how to do that. And Pastor Miller's got a great sermon coming up where he's going to tell us about how they had to have trust in Jesus to take that leap and follow that call. Does anyone know what it may mean to be a fisher of men? Does it mean I'm going to go out and cast this out in the congregation and see who I catch?
Yes.
What's it mean? Well, it means that the disciples were called to go spread the word of Jesus. And as we know for the scouts, the last part of the scout law is a scout is, what is Austin?
Reverent.
Scout is reverent. So we're called to the same goal, is to be the hands and feet of God and Jesus and spread the word. And that goes for all of our kids. All of you here are children of Christ, and we should be led in that same way. You think you can do that with us? Can we all be fisher of men? All right, I think we can all spread the good news, because I think everyone wants to hear that today. All right, can everyone join me for a prayer? Dear God, thank you so much for calling us to be your children and to be fisher of men. Please help guide us in that goal and help us spread your word to the world. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Name, oh, how sweet.
Our scripture reading is Luke 5, 1 through 11. Hear now the word of the Lord. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw, at the water's edge, two boats left there by fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of the fish they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." So they pulled their boats up on the shore, left everything, and followed him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Having heard God's word proclaimed to us in Scripture, let us go now in prayer as God's word comes to us through sermon. Let us pray. Our gracious and loving God, we thank you for another day of life and breath and another opportunity to hear your word proclaimed to us. We pray during this hour that our ears would be open and our eyes would be able to see the message that you have for us this day. Guide us now and speak to our hearts. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. So looking around the sanctuary and seeing so many scouts, it brings back a lot of memories from me when I was a scout. Growing up, scouting was a huge part of my life, and I enjoyed every week going to meetings, going on campouts, service projects, and probably the thing I looked forward to most was our annual summer camp. Every summer, we would go to the Seven Ranges Scout Reservation in Southeast Ohio. And we would make our way there and spend the entire week camping, learning how to use our pocket knives, building fires, pulling pranks, doing all of the things that make camp fun. But probably the thing about camp that I looked forward to the most, and I think my friends looked forward to, was going swimming. At our camp, the lake was the center of everything. And the first day you arrived, you would have to go to the lake and pass your swimming test. Because if you were going to go on the boats that week, if you were going to enjoy swimming in the deep water, if you wanted to do any of that, you had to pass your test. Now, we would all line up on the dock, and this lake, let's just say it wasn't the most inviting body of water that one would want to go to. It was dark, very cold, and there were legends of sea monsters. I have no firsthand experience with the sea monster. Older scouts told me about the sea monsters. And so you would stand there on the dock and you would look out into that water, and when the lifeguard blew his whistle, you had to jump in to that deep end of the lake. You had to swim across the swimming area and you had to swim back and show them that you were a capable swimmer. It wasn't always easy to do. When I was just learning to swim, I was pretty scared. But I knew I was good enough to do it, so I jumped into the deep end. Now, there's a time for caution. If you're not a capable swimmer, you should not jump into the deep end. But when it comes to following Jesus, caution is rarely, rarely rarely what he calls us to. When we follow Jesus, he calls us in to the deep ends of life, into those areas of service, into those relationships that are just beyond our comfort zone, just beyond where we're comfortable. When Jesus calls us into the deep end, he calls us to trust. And when we trust, we are called to totally surrender to him. Now, Jesus doesn't want partial surrender. He doesn't want 25 or 50% or 75%. He wants 100% complete trust in him. And our gospel reading this morning is a story about comfort zones, trust, and surrender. It's the morning, and Peter has been out all night fishing. Now, the fishing that Peter has been doing is not the kind of fishing that Mr. Hall showed us with a rod and a reel. Peter was out in a boat with nets. And he would take his net from the side of the boat, and he would cast it out as far as he could into the water. He would let that net sink down, hoping that he'd catch some fish in the net. He'd pull it back to the boat, and then he would do that over and over again. See, now when we think of fishing, we usually think, I'm going to get a nice lawn chair. I'm going to get a nice cooler and a cold beverage and sit it beside me. I'm going to relax, cast my rod and reel, fish, and just have a pleasant afternoon. Peter was not relaxed. He was exhausted. He had spent the whole night throwing his net out, and he was so tired. And built on top of that, he was frustrated because he didn't catch anything. He had put all of his effort into fishing and nothing came back. Have you ever had one of those days where you feel like you have worked the entire day, you have been incredibly busy, and you have nothing to show for it? Yes. That's how Peter felt that morning. And as he was cleaning his nets, washing them, preparing them for the next night's fishing trip, Jesus comes along, being followed by huge crowds of people wanting to hear all that he has to say. And Jesus begins to teach from a boat. And then Jesus said to Simon, "Why don't you go out into the deep water and let down your nets?" And Peter has this line that has really always stuck with me. He says, "Master, we've worked all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the nets." Now, it's that line, "because you say so, I will let down the nets," that has caught my attention. Now, we read that, and it's easy to think, you know, Peter, he's being sarcastic there. You know, "I've done all this work, but because you say so, I'm going to go do it." But I don't think Peter's being sarcastic. I think Peter's being trusting here. You see, when someone that we trust asks us to do something maybe that sounds a little ludicrous or crazy, we do it not because we believe that we can do the thing, but because we trust the person who asked us to do the thing. If you have a leader that you believe in, that you trust, you will go to the ends of the earth for that person because you believe in them. And I think that's what happened here. Peter believed in Jesus, and he was willing to go to the ends of the earth because Jesus said it. So Peter went out not because he understood the command, but he trusted the one who gave him the command. And he went out throwing his nets in the deep water, not because he thought he was going to bring back a boatload of fish, but because he trusted that Jesus wanted him to do something. And because Jesus was trustworthy, that gave Peter the courage to go into the deep waters, to go just beyond his comfort zone. You see, Peter was a smart guy. He was a fisherman. He knew where the fish liked to congregate. He knew how to do his job. And now Jesus was telling him to go back out just one more time and try it. So Peter said, Jesus, okay. Okay. I'll do it because I trust you. And I think each one of us in this life is being called by Jesus just beyond our comfort zones, into the deep waters that he has for us. Because Jesus never lets us stay in the shallows. He always calls us out into the deep. And when we go into the deep, we have to surrender ourselves completely to him. We have to step out of our comfort zone. A person who taught me this lesson well is a leadership coach named Drew Dudley. Drew Dudley is a leadership coach in Canada, and he gave a TED talk where he told a story about his last day in college. He was getting ready to graduate. He was putting together all of his dorm room things, all of his paperwork finishing up, and as he was walking through campus, a young woman ran up to him and grabbed his arm and said, "Drew Dudley, I need to talk to you. You don't remember me, and we have not spent time together in college, but you had an incredibly important role in my life. Because when I was a freshman and I showed up to campus here, I was incredibly nervous about coming to college. You see, the day before registration, my parents and I were sitting in a hotel room, and I was crying my eyes out because I was so nervous about coming to school. And they told me that the next day when we went in to register, if I felt like I needed to leave, that they would let me do that. And so the next day came, and I was standing with mom and dad, and we were in line to register for classes with all the other people on campus that day. And I was overcome with anxiety. I wanted nothing more than to leave. So I made this internal decision that I was going to leave, and I had this peace. I knew it was the right decision. And just as I was getting ready to turn and tell mom and dad that I was ready to leave, you came walking out of the student union building with a big bucket of lollipops and this ridiculous looking hat on your head. And you walked over to me and you just stared at me with this really creepy look on your face. And then you looked to the side and you saw the young man who was in line behind me, and you pulled out a lollipop and you gave it to him. And you said to him with a straight face, "You need to hand this beautiful woman a lollipop." And you should have seen that kid's face turn beet red when he did it. He couldn't even look me in the eye, but he just held out the lollipop and he gave it to me. And as soon as I took the lollipop, you looked at my parents with that stern look on your face and you said, "Uh-huh, you see? Just one day away from home, and she's already taking candy from strangers." And as soon as you said that, everybody started laughing. And she said, "Drew, this sounds really cheesy, but as soon as everybody started laughing, I knew that I was home. I knew this was the place that I wanted to be. And I decided to stay there for college." Drew went out into the deep waters and he left his comfort zone and showed spontaneous and abundant kindness to a person who needed it. And when Drew was giving this TED talk, he made this fascinating comment when he said, "You know what the kicker of this whole story is? I have no memory of that event ever happening." Now, barring any medical explanation for why a person would forget that, isn't it interesting that one event that profoundly shaped a person's life was not remembered by the person who caused it. And this young woman said to Drew, "You know that guy? He and I are still dating." And when Drew gave his TED talk, he mentioned that he had received a wedding invitation from that couple. An event that Drew didn't even remember informed one of the biggest decisions this young woman would make in her entire life. Because Drew stepped out of his comfort zone, he had a direct impact on the course of her life. That's pretty amazing. It's also pretty scary to think that one interaction that we may not even remember can have that much of an impact on another person's life. You see, when we come into contact with people, we can either make their lives better or we can make them worse. And just the smallest comment to someone, we may not think twice about it, but it can ruin their day. Because we have no idea what people are going through when we see them. Because let's face the facts, we are all good actors. We do a great job putting up a front. And we do a great job not letting people see what's really going on inside. We don't know the phone call that a person received earlier in the day or the email. We don't know the anxiety they're feeling about their aunt. We don't know the hurtful words they heard earlier that day. And so whenever we encounter someone, it is always the best option to default on the side of grace and compassion. When we go out into these deep waters, places just outside of our comfort zone, it can be scary. It is a scary thing to go into the deep. When Jesus called Peter out into the deep waters, he was telling Peter to literally go out into the deeper part of the lake. But that phrase, deep waters, carried with it a deeper meaning. In the Old Testament, the phrase deep waters carries with it the idea of a primordial sea, a symbol of chaos and uncertainty. In Psalm 69, the psalmist cries out, "Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sink in the miry depths where there is no foothold. I have come into the deep waters. The floods engulf me." To put our nets in the deep waters and to go just beyond our comfort zone is scary. But God never leaves us in the shallows, because God knows that growth only comes in the deep. As disciples like Peter, each of us is called by Christ to go into the deep end of life, that place just beyond where we are comfortable, where we can rely on our skills. The call of Christian discipleship is the call to go into the deep waters, where our skills will be tested, our faith stretched, where we'll have to struggle and we'll have to trust. But know this, friends. Even though the deep waters are scary, we are not in them alone. The prophet Isaiah said, "When you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown." Because paradoxically, it's in the deep waters where we find the deepest grace. Because in all things, going into the deep waters is about total surrender. Letting go of the belief that you have everything figured out, letting go of the belief that you can control every scenario and situation in life. Going into the deep waters requires trust. Trusting that the God who met you on the shore will be the same God who was with you in the boat, who will be the same God who is with you when you return, who will be the same God yesterday, today, and forever. So don't be afraid of whatever deep waters God is calling you to. Don't be afraid to say yes to a new opportunity. Don't be afraid to leave the shallows, because the opportunities that you are waiting for are in the deep waters. And there are countless people who need you to go there.
Confess our faith together, saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He sent into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
To the Father and to the Son.
be seated. As we come now to our time of prayer, we want to be in prayer for the family and friends of Beverly Caldwell, who passed away recently and whose service is this afternoon at 3 p.m. in the sanctuary. We also want to pray for the young child about whom an Amber Alert was issued this morning in Mint Hill, and we pray for God's mercy and protection and the safety of that child. So friends, let us now go to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come before you today with thanksgiving in our hearts for all the ways you shower us with grace and with goodness. We thank you most of all for our loving Savior, Jesus Christ, who finds us while we are washing our nets and feeling exhausted. We thank you for coming to us and finding us before we could ever think to come to you. Holy God, you have made us and redeemed us through Christ to be your witnesses in the world, to be fishers of people, to serve your kingdom now and forever. And imperfect as we are, you send us out into the deep waters. Give us the courage to go there. We pray for the church around the world in all its rich diversity. We pray that your church and its leaders would lead with humility and grace, showing the world the joy of a new life in Christ. We pray for all public authorities, our local, state, and national leaders. May their hearts incline to justice and seeking the common good for all. Give them the courage to lead with integrity. We pray for all those who struggle with faith, who long for answers to questions, who want to believe with their whole hearts, but who struggle. Cover them with your grace, your presence, and your wisdom. We pray for all who need healing and hope, for those who have injuries of body, mind, or soul, grant them healing. For those in despair, grant them hope. We pray for those who have been wounded in this world, who have suffered from war, oppression, famine, disease, or who have been on the receiving end of harsh words and judgmental attitudes. Grant them rescue. Gracious God, you are the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. In all things, we trust in your providence and care. Hear now the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In Luke 5, we hear how Jesus stepped onto Simon's empty fishing boat and asked Simon to put a little way from the shore so Jesus could speak to the crowd. It's hard to believe this fisherman would respond so positively to the request of a stranger. These fishermen went on to be amazed at their huge catch. No wonder Simon Peter fell on his knees, saying, Go away from me. This was preposterous. Instead of going away, Jesus announced, From now on, you will be catching people. And Peter, James, and John brought their boats to shore, left everything and followed, becoming disciples of Jesus. Though most of us don't have such a dramatic story of coming to faith or becoming a disciple of Jesus, many have stepped up over the centuries, become avid believers and full-time followers, like my scoutmaster, John Porter, and my uncle, Billy Hawkins. What have you brought to offer Jesus this day? The one who continues to call you as a disciple asks for nothing less than your whole life. So bring yourself and the symbols of your life as we make our offering this morning. Here at Philadelphia Presbyterian Church, you can give your offering in four different ways. in person, in one of the baskets at the front or the back of the church, online on the church website, by text, or by mailing your gift. However you give, be sure that your gift is appreciated.
Good morning. My name is Jonathan Porter. I'm the Scoutmaster of Troop 65, and it's a real honor to stand before you today on behalf of PAC 65, Troop 65, and Venture Crew 1465 to give you this brief report. I'd like to begin by thanking Pastor Miller and all of you for inviting us to join you here for this fellowship. The Scout Oath, and the Scout Oath begins with duty to God, and the Scout Law ends with a Scout is reverent. So in a real sense, being a scout begins and ends with God. During these uncertain times of chaos with this pandemic, it has affected all of us, including scouting program. I would like to share these words from Troy Bromgardner. He's the Cub Master of PAC 65, and the sentiment he conveys in them is echoed by the leaders of the troop and the crew. Cub Scout PAC 65 continues to be an active and growing group, providing educational experiences to elementary youth and their families. Since 2020, the PAC has grown from a low of 35 scouts to 61 scouts currently. This growth is in part due to the fact, due to other scout groups being barred from meeting by their charter organizations. Philadelphia Presbyterian support of the scouting program provides critical meeting spaces, indoors and outdoors, where our scouts can safely stay connected. Because of this opportunity, we have been able to continue the scouting, including fall and spring campouts at Lake Norman State Park and Camp Barnhart north of Abramarle. Scouts completed the Rain Gutter Regatta and the Pinewood Derby, building projects, and continue to learn valuable life lessons. A group of Arrow of Light Scouts will continue their path to Eagle by crossing over into Troop 65 last March. Overall, PAC 65 is thriving because the support provided by Philadelphia Presbyterian. We thank you for continuing to partner with us in this important ministry to the elementary youth of Mint Hill and beyond. PAC 65 serves youths from kindergarten through fifth grade. So we encourage you, if you have that age group, to bring them and join our PAC. Venture Crew 1465 currently has 31 youth, ages 14 to 21, and 21 adults. The Venture Crew participated in a wilderness survival weekend paddling out to an island in Clark's Hill Lake in Georgia, where they erected shelters and survived freezing temperatures. They participated in a rendezvous, which is a gathering and competition of various crews at Camp Grimes. And they attended Summit High Adventure Camp in West Virginia for a week. They panned for gold, they backpacked, they roller skated, they learned to play tennis, and they learned how to carve wood. Venture Crew 65 had two of their members receive the Summit rank, which is the highest rank a crew member can earn and is the equivalent of the troop of the Boy Scouts Eagle rank. Again, if you have youths age 14 to 21 and they love adventure, we would love to have them join our crew. And Troop 65, which is dear to my heart, is entering its 68th year of service. We currently have 40 registered Boy Scouts and 24 adults. Our scouts have earned over 138 merit badges since the COVID hit. We had two Eagle Scouts this past year, which brings our number, and I had to correct myself on this from this morning, to 126 to date. I would like to ask all Eagle Scouts currently in attendance to please rise and be recognized. Thank you. You may be seated. To date, the Troop 65 has completed 18 Eagle projects at the Mint Hill Historic Society, and we have completed over 50 Eagle projects here at Philadelphia Presbyterian. We currently have one that's underway, it's almost done, and I believe we have a couple of more coming up. In lieu of a summary of the Troop's activities for the past year and a half, I would like to just reiterate our gratitude for your support. The past 2 years were difficult for everyone. However, because of your steadfast support of the PAC, the crew, and the Troop, we have throughout this pandemic been able to supply a consistent and steady program for the youth and the future leaders of our community. At a time when many were suffering in isolation and uncertainty, we were able to provide, because of you, a safe and active outdoor program to engage and help build the character and the drive of many of these young men and women. Sorry, crew. He gives us the way. Indeed, your support shows us that when we hold fast to God in faith, He gives us the way and the strength to face and overcome whatever obstacles confront us, the deep waters that Pastor Miller talked about. I believe that many of these young scouts will be useful in God's hands in bringing His blessings and grace to others in the future when they're facing their deep waters. In closing, just again, on behalf of the PAC, the crew, and the Troop, I would like to thank all of you for your ongoing prayers and support of our mission in training up youth to be of high religious and moral character. Would we all please rise and let's sing hymn 720, Jesus Calls Us. Thank you.
Before we exit today with our charge and a benediction, I would like to say a special prayer and offer a blessing for our scouts. So, congregation, I would like us all to be a part of this prayer and blessing. So please, congregation, extend your hands with palms open to the scouts. And scouts and leaders, please extend your palms facing up as the sign of receiving a blessing. Let us now ask God's blessing upon the scouting program of Philadelphia. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for all the good things that you provide to us, and we thank you for the ways that you are using the scouting program here and across the country to raise up leaders for our country and for our society. We thank you for the sacrifices being made by the adults, sacrifices of time and money. Thank you for the sacrifices that these children, these young people, are making of their own time. And we pray that you would use the scouting time that they are in to form them into leaders that will change and influence your world for the good. Give them courage, give them strength, and watch over them. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, into whatever deep waters God is calling you this week, know this. You do not go into these waters alone. The one who calls you out off of the shore will be with you in the boat. You have partners in other boats with you, and that one who calls you will lead you home. So be of good courage this week, dear friends. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good luck.